Are we ready? It's mind pump time.
All right, you ready for some free stuff?
Here's what you got to do to win free access to MAPS, HIT, high intensity interval training. By the way, it's done right. Not like everybody else that does it, who does it wrong, where they just go haphazardly to one exercise to another, end up burning a bunch of muscle in the process. Not with this program. With this program, you burn body fat. You might actually even build a little bit of muscle. We designed it ourselves. Here's how you can win free access. Leave a comment below in the first 24 hours that we drop this episode. And if we pick your comment as the best comment of all the comments, you'll get free access. Now, everybody else, subscribe to this channel, turn on your notifications so that you know when we post these videos so that you can enter to win free stuff. By the way, we give away free stuff every single time we drop an episode on this channel. Also, one more thing, we are running a sale on two things. So one is a workout program. The other is a workout program bundle, which combines multiple programs. So the first thing that's on sale, MAPS Aesthetic, 50% off. The second thing that's on sale is the Extreme Fitness Bundle, which has multiple programs put together. That's also 50% off. You can learn more at mapsfitnessproducts.com, or you could just sign up. But if you sign up, use the code MAYSPECIAL for that discount. All right, enjoy the podcast. Ride and dirty. What does that mean, ride and dirty? Does that mean you...
I don't know.
Does that mean you
it means you're driving with... No, it means you're driving with drugs.
Oh, I thought it meant like you sharded.
I thought it... Okay.
You guys ever do that?
Okay, or you thought the same
you're
thing.
Yeah, see, yeah. You're driving and you're like, where's the bathroom?
Yeah.
I can't get there.
Like, I'm riding dirty right now. I need to pull over.
Before you know it, you're riding dirty.
I mean, yeah. It could mean that for you. I could see that.
I mean, riding muddy might be.
I'm more likely to ride dirty like that than with drugs in my car.
Yeah.
You know what I'm
saying? So the other one was the ghost ride the whip thing, right? So they would like get out of the car and then they'd just be like, yeah, and the car would keep going.
Yeah.
That's the thing.
Isn't that funny how trends today were just bad ideas in the past?
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like in the past, it's like, get out of your car while it's driving. It's right. A bad idea.
Yeah.
And then they're like, wait a minute.
Can you think of other examples?
This is a trend.
Gallon of milk challenge.
What?
Have they done that one again? That was big in our day.
Oh, you have to drink a gallon?
The whole gallon.
It makes you throw up.
It's impossible. Nobody can ever do it.
Yeah, isn't there like a reaction, right?
Uh-huh.
Did you guys ever hear about that? Was it a lady or a guy that died because there was a radio station challenge?
The water challenge.
Yes.
Yes, yeah, I did hear about
who
that.
That was local, I think. Holding her pee, right? Isn't that one?
No, it was just who can. Oh, that was part of it.
There's one where something happened because you had to keep your hand on the like a little Toyota pickup truck or something.
Yeah, to win it
and keep drinking.
Yeah,
and they died from you actually drown. Your cells actually drown from having too much water.
Is that what it was?
Yeah. Yeah.
It wasn't from holding the pee. No, Doug, I think they're wrong.
I think there's two different things we're talking about.
Yeah, exactly. Really.
There was one, win a wee by holding your wee. You remember that?
And did someone get hurt?
That's the one I think
a woman died from doing that, I think.
But that was because of the water again.
Well, that's right.
You're not going to die from holding your pee.
No, maybe she was drinking at the same time.
Yes. Yeah. And if you drink too much water, you drown.
This is bad.
But you can hold your pee as long as you want. It won't kill you.
Hmm. Is it true to know water was so deadly?
Feels like it's going to kill me when I do that.
It'll hurt you.
Can you hold a pee, or can you guys hold a poop longer?
Oh, pee! I mean,
come on,
you can hold a pee longer.
When it's time to go,
I don't know. I can kind
of. I can hold.
Forget it. You know, just suck it back in, and it's done.
Yeah, you guys are weird like that.
Yeah, just kind of.
We'll be going somewhere, and you'll be like, "I got
to
poop." And
I'll
never
get
mind.
To that later today.
How?
I'll get to that later today,
and then it's a real problem.
How is that? How do you do that?
I don't know.
I need to learn.
I don't know. It's like a whole vacuum maneuver.
No, for me the two
good
is
core strength.
When I hear this,
very much.
Oh, guys, I gotta go. Could be halfway through the podcast. In fact, I think I did that once.
Yeah.
With the podcast.
Just the turtle.
But you can't do the pee, huh?
Turtle no. Ready.
Pee is bad for all bad for me.
It's because you have weak pelvic floor muscles.
Is that what it is?
Yeah, you need to work on your
I have like a little like Justin's helmet over there, like a little itty bitty
penis. Oh, sorry. I thought we were gonna say the same thing again, remember?
You guys.
Like we did last time.
We gotta unconnect you guys.
Holy snap.
Jeez.
Are we on over here, Doug?
We sure are.
We are.
Thanks, Doug. Oh, that's why Doug's making faces over there. Hey, did you guys hear about Bill Gates?
I mean, didn't we just bring him up? Is there more developments? More?
Yeah, dude, he had an affair with his assistant, and he confirmed it.
Oh, really?
Yeah, dude.
Is that to take heat away from his Epstein logs?
I don't know, but it might be just that he's a philandering philanthropist.
Wow,
that's a tongue twister.
You know what I mean? You know what's funny is that you can't tell by looking at someone, right? Like if I look at Bill Gates,
like he doesn't look like he's having sex.
Like he's a little hound dog.
He doesn't look like he's having sex at all.
No.
Looks like, and he also doesn't look like someone anyone would want to have sex with, right?
No.
You know what I'm saying?
I mean, imagine it.
How did
that happen?
I imagine, no idea. You're the person having sex with him, your desired outcome is just like, hopefully I get some shut up money, right?
Right.
That's like,
why do you put the keyboard on my back? You know, what's that all about? I just picture that. You can't stop working.
You don't need a desk.
Yeah.
Use my back.
Use my back.
That's real news, though. That really came out.
Yeah.
I did not see that anywhere. Yeah, did you know that?
No.
It was a woman.
I should know that.
It was a woman at Microsoft, a lady at Microsoft.
Wow.
And he apparently had
now. Has this been like a long ongoing thing, or did it just happen once? Or like, I mean,
he confirmed.
Is this the reason why the divorce happened? Like,
no. He actually
tell me more here.
He actually confirmed it. It was a board. Bill Gates left Microsoft board after affair with female staffer in 2000. So she wrote,
that was over 20 years ago.
No. She wrote a letter. Oh, there's more to the story. I didn't even know that. Oh, there's a picture of her. Look at that.
Oh.
He's not.
What's she look like?
Oh no, that's his wife. Never mind.
Okay.
So it says here.
See, Doug, look up who he had an affair with. There, I want to see what she looks like.
I know, right?
Yeah, I know.
Watch her be like a dime piece.
Super hot.
Just bad.
No one of Bill's Aryans.
Just bad.
No way.
Yeah.
He's like the most unsexiest thing of all time. It says here. So check this. I didn't know this. The woman he had an affair with. Remember when the whole Me Too thing was happening and all these? It was just going crazy.
Yeah.
When that happened, she wrote a letter. And she demanded that his wife read it. So she exposed it 19 years later.
Whoa.
I know, right?
Yeah.
Wait. Back up here. She wrote a letter 19 years ago, but they didn't release it.
19 years later. So in 2000, they had the affair.
Okay.
2019, right? So that's 19 years later. She wrote a letter, and that's now what's coming
up. So was it ongoing? So it was like another relationship he had with this woman?
I don't know.
What did you do, like skim the article or what?
I read the headline, and now I'm bringing
Jesus,
it up.
Jesus, this is this guy, man.
Look it up.
I mean, it's something. Yeah, here you guys, chew on
come on,
I'm waiting for Doug to throw me a bone so I could like talk about it, but he ain't giving me nothing.
I mean,
right now.
Yeah, I'll read the highlights.
I do
want
to see what she looks like. I don't know why. It says here, okay?
This is the highlights of the article. Bill Gates, 65, admitted to an affair with a female Microsoft employee.
Like, how young was she?
The employee, a Microsoft engineer, wrote to the company board in 2019 and allegedly asked that Gates' estranged wife read her letter. Gates resigned suddenly from the board in 2020 after the company initiated an independent investigation by a law firm. A spokeswoman for Gates said his decision to leave the board had nothing to do with the affair.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
Really?
Weird.
Yeah.
The Wall Street Journal report came out a short time after revelations emerged that Gates had had asked out two female staff members.
Oh.
What? He's a hound.
Now, how do you guys feel about
this?
He's
doubling up.
You know, like when like it comes out that a celebrity cheated, this and that, or a politician, like remember when the whole thing with Clinton first, right? Like, how do you guys feel about that as far as like the uproar that happens? Like, do you feel like that matters? Like, does it matter that person is doing something like that? Like, does his sex life have anything to do with how he is? Yeah. He should be able to run Microsoft. I mean, where's your stance on that?
I feel like we're just so jaded now. I just feel like whatever. You know, like who really cares at this point?
Yeah, I think you know what it is that we put people on like this pedestal, celebrities or whatever. And so when something like that comes out, it's like, oh my gosh, can you believe that? Whatever. But this shit happens all the time.
And is it different because it was internal with an employee, and would it be less of a big deal if
that's
it was like
the problematic part, probably.
Dude, think about like what a dumb move. And by the way, I mean, I know I'm sounding like I'm judging him, and I know a lot of smart people have made stupid decisions like this, but bro, you're the richest man in the world.
Yeah.
You're very well known.
Yeah.
And not only did you choose to cheat on your wife, but you did it with an employee.
Yeah.
I know. Isn't there like a famous island he could have went to and nobody would have gotten in trouble?
Allegedly, there's a place.
Is there a place?
Yes.
Supposedly famous people could go to and do weird shit and not get in trouble.
Yeah.
He called up Epstein.
Hey, look. Sweep it under the carpet.
I can't keep it in the pants, bro.
Yeah.
Can I come to your island?
Yeah, I keep picturing because I don't know. I keep thinking of like Ghostbusters. You remember when I think it was Janine and then Egon, they had this like relationship.
Yeah.
And then that's what I picture. Like her and him, like these two, like
super weird
uber nerd.
First shocked me, and then I went, I guess, the most of all celebrity affairs or whatever. When Arnold's like son came out,
oh, yeah,
and he ended up having sex with his housekeeper,
yeah,
and she was not She was not good looking at all.
Yeah. I think.
Remember
that? Look, but then he looks just like
him. I was gonna say, is her son the one that looks exactly like him?
Bro, yes. All of his kids.
And then the other one doesn't as much.
All of his kids with what's his wife, ex-wife's name? Maria Shriver. Maria, right?
Yeah, is that her
name?
One of the Kennedys.
All of her all of his kids, none of them look like him. None of them look like Arnold.
Except for him.
Yeah. The one that he banged, his the housekeeper, looks exactly like Arnold.
Yeah.
And I follow him, by the way, on Instagram.
Joe something, right?
He seems pretty cool.
He's all into working out and stuff.
Yeah.
how wild, right?
It is wild.
Yeah, that one blew me away when that happened. I was like, Arnold, what are you doing, dude?
Yeah. Well, it's you know, sort of proximity, I guess.
She was there.
She's there. I was like, hey, I just took a shower. What? Let's do something.
I'm cleaning the floors. Whoa.
How's that saying go? Like, you can eat filet mignon every night, but every once in a while a hot dog sounds good. Is that where it comes, right?
Yeah, look at him flexing up there. Yeah, he's even got his dad's kind of like muscle shape and everything.
I know. It's bizarre.
Isn't that wild?
Yeah.
That's weird. You know, you ever seen pictures of Arnold when he was like 18, 19?
Yeah.
Just massive.
Just a hoss.
Yeah, I guess the rumor is that he got on the D-ball real. That's somebody who's like 19 right there in that left picture.
Wow.
Yeah. He's a beast.
Wow.
Yeah, and I guess the story is that he got his hands on anabolics at a young age, and that's why he looks like that when he's 18 years old.
Why, is this a dumb question? Why does he not carry the same last name?
They weren't married.
So? Yeah. Still a son. He wouldn't take he would just automatically take his.
Legally, that's the way you do it. You have to legally put it on your birth certificate.
Oh, really? So mm-hmm. I didn't know that.
Your son could have put your wife's last name or anybody, whatever you guys choose. So this kid was born. The mom is like, well, he's not here, so don't give him his last name.
Mm. Yeah.
Because it came out. How much later did it come out? I don't remember how old he was when it came out. It wasn't that long ago.
I think the kid was like 12 years later or something like that.
Yeah, it was quite a bit
later. It was over a decade later.
So that makes sense.
I know, right?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Oh, man. Hey, speaking of kids, so we started feeding my son like solids now,
mm-hmm.
right? So we found, you guys have seen the Serenity Kids baby food?
Love it.
Oh, yeah.
Really good stuff.
You guys told me all about that.
Yeah, really good stuff, right? It's all, there's like no preservatives, no, it's really, really healthy, right? Grass-fed meat, whatever. Anyway, so we started feeding him food, these solids, just to see what his, and my kid is an eating machine.
Yeah.
He's like...
He's pumping them with protein now.
Bro, he's like... We took him to my parents' house to visit, and Jessica's like... And so here's the thing. So in my culture, it's like a sport to see how much you could feed your kids and grandkids. And it's really interesting. Like, I don't notice it because I grew up with it.
Right.
But when I step outside of it and it's pointed out to me, I'm like, I guess you're right.
Now, does that challenge you and Jessica at
all?
Okay.
So, because when I'll give you an example, right? Here's a story. So, like, when me and my cousins would go to my grandma's house and she'd cook dinner, she would literally come out with money and say, whoever finishes first gets this money. So we'd be like, going as fast as we could.
Wow.
Yeah.
Wow.
And my grandma would follow us around when we were little with food. We'd be outside playing. She'd go outside with the food. And while we're playing, she'd like do this with the spoon. And so you're like, okay, I'm playing.
Yeah, I'm good.
Like, they just feed the shit out of you, right? So my son, we bring him to my parents' house. And Jessica, you know, had, you know, some baby food. We also make our own, right? So she pureed grass-fed beef with sweet potato or whatever. So she gave it to my mom, and she's like, you can feed him. Now, my son is like every Italian grandmother's dream, because it doesn't matter. You put the spoon to his face, he opens his mouth. So she feeds hella fast. He's just eating hella fast. And Jessica's like, it's too fast. I think he's going too fast.
Someone was asking
But he won't stop. He'll just keep going.
Control Nana.
Oh, yeah.
Someone was asking me if that was really hard for us to do that with Max's food. Like, man, isn't that so much work for mm-hmm. you guys to do that? And Katrina's like, it really isn't, because all we do is we just puree the food that we make for ourselves.
Yeah.
And then he freezes it.
Yeah, exactly. And she just, we portion it out, freeze it, and then now he's set for the next couple of weeks.
But so, you know, some kids like are more picky, or they don't want to eat or whatever. My boy, man, he's like, Jessica's like, am I feeding him too much? I'm like, I think he'll tell you when he's full. Yeah. No, he'll just keep going, you know? Little,
he's just in a growth phase.
Oh, yeah. He's going to become a little chunker. Squeeze the shit out of those little legs. I love that, man.
Oh, yeah.
It's a good age, dude.
Dude, this weekend I was had kind of a funny weekend. I went to this zombie movie, and the theaters are open.
Wait,
again.
Zombie movie?
Yeah, there was a zombie movie out.
Is it new?
It's made for TV. They did not disclose that because it's a Netflix film. So it's technically it's a movie, and it was in the theater, and so we're like, let's give it a try. I have no... Like I didn't see any kind of previews for it. Like I have no idea what I'm in for.
Surprise.
Totally surprise. I'm like, it could either be like Shaun of the Dead kind of like humor, or it could be like
28 days later
and scare the shit out of me. You know, either way I'm in. You know, let's figure this out. And so we're in there and they're watching it, and man, they just could not decide whether or not to make it a funny movie or like super dramatic. And it just became just insanely awful. I wanted to just throw stuff at it. It was so bad. It's like they're trying to develop a you know, a romantic interest in this
in
happens
a zombie
like,
movie?
Yeah, yeah. In the middle of it, and it gets all like dramatic, and she's like, you know, I loved you and this, and then she opens the door and all of a sudden a zombie just snaps her neck, you know, in half, and then it's over. It's like, that's what we led up to. And like that's all you give us?
Now, are you guys big on like looking at reviews before you go watch any movie or download it or whatever like that if you're at home streaming? Like,
you know, I do.
Usually.
Yeah, I like to because they're actually pretty accurate. And I've tested so many times. I've watched a trailer.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm convinced it's going to be a good movie. Then I read the reviews, and the reviews are bad, and I still think it's going to be a good movie.
Yeah.
Usually the reviews are right.
Every now and then, you got to take a chance. You guys got to do this. Yeah. Like it's like, and then if you know it's a total dud, then you can start having fun with it.
Yeah.
And start talking shit.
Do you go with your wife?
No, I went with my friends.
I was going to say, if you're with your wife, you just start making out or
she
something.
That's
what we're doing.
That would be a zombie movie. Yeah. You know how weird that would be? You see, like a couple, like, you know, giving each other tongue and fucking in a zombie movie.
That's what makes
movie?
It fun, Adam.
Like, they are. Yeah. That's a different
couple. Hey, listen,
couple.
This movie
people
sucks.
Getting their heads
you want to make out right now instead?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. You know, there's
40-year-old couples.
Do you know there's actually like a science to like a perfect review rating? Do you know that?
What do you mean?
4.2 to 4.76 or 7.5.
So 5 is not a good review?
5 is not good.
Why?
Well, I mean, good for the average person. So what happened, the psychology behind this is this. I forget what book this was in, but they say that if you see all 5 stars, that it's your-
It doesn't seem real?
Yes.
Oh.
You question it right away. Like, oh, this, I mean, perfect. Not everybody's going to vote perfect on this. So if it falls between the 4.2 to like 4.7, somewhere in that range, it's supposed to be like the sweet spot for reviews for it to be realistic. And like, and if it's right below that, way less people will watch. If it's right above that, then people
if you
also,
like, if you guys like, I know Justin will probably like this, right? If you like creative film,
yeah.
And whether it's animated or not, but something creative, you got to watch Love, Death, and Robots on Netflix.
I've seen that.
You saw the first season. Second season is out.
The new one.
Yes.
Sweet.
Really smart, right? Yeah. So they're animated, and the animations are different. Sometimes,
you've talked about this before. You tried to get us to watch this before.
Dude, it's really smart. It's really good. They're like 12 minutes long, and they always have a twist, or it's weird. One of them, the animation is so good that like 2 or 3 times throughout, I'm like, is this film or is this animation? That's how good the CGI is getting with some
it's
of the
getting
stuff.
Crazy.
The only way I could tell is when I looked up closely at the faces of the people. Otherwise, I could not tell that it was. I thought it was film.
Yeah. You have such different tastes than I do. I go. I use Doug's movie referrals. I will watch. Mm. I've tried a few of yours, and that was one of them too. I'm just not, bro.
You like the straightforward shit.
If you guys can handle like really bad films and like have fun with them, here's one for you. It's a class of 1984. And you would never know it, but Michael J. Fox makes his like very first appearance in this movie, and it is literally a turd sandwich, but it's so funny because it's so wrong. Like there's people like at school, there's these punks like take over the school, and it's this whole thing that basically they take over the school and everybody's under their tyranny and all this stuff, and like people are like getting strung out in class like on heroin. There's people like having sex all over the place.
Because that happened in 1984.
I was like, this is so raunchy and out there. It's crazy.
Doug, do you ever listen to any of these guys' referrals and go watch any of the movies that they be referring here?
Never.
Like, yeah. You have to have a creative.
I think you had to have tried. Did you try? I tried early on.
I tried a couple of them, and it's like, I'm going to stick with Adams.
Sometimes I like the weird shit, you know?
Sometimes.
Yeah.
I find it more rare that we all align on something. It's you guys are always into like weird.
They're like pop music, and we're like,
stop.
You know what I mean?
There's nothing pop music about the movies.
It's true. Side of things.
You guys are like, I like the stuff everyone else likes.
Yeah, I like it.
If you
want to
be like everyone else, you know what I mean? I, you know,
all the people with taste.
I just go by the reviews.
Yeah, like be like people with taste. I'm with you, Doug.
I only like the movies that everyone else says is cool.
Yeah.
Anyway, I'm gonna take a left turn here and tell you guys about the most fascinating study I've ever read in my entire life.
What?
It's a big statement.
That's a just huge statement.
But it's
Back up.
It's legit.
Okay.
Okay, ready for this? Yes. So somebody DM'd this to me, and I thought, no way. So I looked it up, and it's real. There's a mushroom, a rare mushroom that grows in Hawaii. And the legend and stories were that if women smell this mushroom, it produces very strong arousing effects and orgasm, spontaneous orgasm. This is real. So they actually went and found this mushroom and tested it with these female scientists. Yeah. Now here's a trip. Yeah. The men smelled the mushroom and they all thought it was repulsive. It had no effect on the men whatsoever. The women felt aroused, and one woman had a spontaneous orgasm from this. Swear to God.
And Calvin Klein has not made a cologne out of it yet?
Yeah. No. So think about this.
They're missing out.
Think about this mushroom. Can you think of anything that's going to be make more money than this freaking rare mushroom?
And is this new information?
Yeah, dude. I'll pull up the. It's.
Does it smell like dirty underwear? Or
something? I don't know if that works for you. Yes, I guess. No, this
What is your wife into?
So check this out.
Driving around with mud bud.
I don't know. It's just like what, like, you know, the pheromone thing for men. Like, what are we giving them?
So you guys don't like honestly. Poop? I'm into you guys on poop.
We don't smell good. So, I mean, you guys say you do, but you don't. So,
but it still turns you on.
I'm just honest.
No. So check this out, right? This was a Science Alert even wrote about this. By the way,
here it is.
Look at that.
It's very phallic.
Yeah, it is.
Yeah. No, it's wild. So it's a old study. So the study was done in 2000.
It's a grower.
But it started gaining a lot of attention because people found it, but it's legit. So a pair of medical scientists published a report, International Journal of Medicinal Mushrooms.
Is there a name?
Where can we get these?
Yeah, is there a name?
You know what they've named the mushroom? So it belongs to the Dictyphora genus.
Stop it.
Hey, all right, now you're pulling our leg.
No!
No, dude, the scientists do stuff like that.
No, you know what they named it? Phallus. They literally named the mushroom Phallus. So it only grows on top of the 600 to 1,000-year-old lava flows of Hawaii. Wow. And the scientists John C. Holliday and Noah Soul described it as particularly difficult to find.
I'll be foraging.
So listen to this. They did a smell test. They did a smell test on 16 female and 10 male volunteers. Six of the women reportedly experienced a mild spontaneous orgasm when they sniffed the mushroom, while the remaining 10 were found to have an increased heart rate when given a smaller dose. Now, the men thought it was gross.
Dude.
What the fuck?
It's amazing.
How weird is that?
That is weird.
Now, I can't,
interesting, though.
Now, here's
a breakthrough.
This could become like an incredible pharmaceutical.
Aphrodisiac.
Now, yeah, and now I'm thinking like this, because this study was in 2001. Why didn't this blow up?
Right. Why have we not found a few and then actually found a way to clone them and make tons of them?
Here's what I think. You cannot patent something that is found in nature. So here's what I think.
Yeah, but you could recreate it though, right?
I think pharmaceutical companies are getting this mushroom and trying to figure out how to make synthetic patentable, is that the right word? Versions of this.
Yeah.
Because think about this. Think about like how many people would buy that if you just buy a bottle, the doctor could prescribe it to you.
Oh, I see a dollar sign.
Did you?
Yeah, your wife's angry at you. You just walk up to her.
You should.
You sure you're mad at me right
this
now?
Tea.
Yeah.
Text our boy over at Four Sigmatic. What's his name? I'm sure he's got
Taro.
Taro, yeah. I bet he's on it, right?
It's not cordyceps, I'll tell you.
He's like the mushroom guy, dude. He's gotta know this.
I don't know. Yeah.
Send him a message.
How wild is that though?
No, that's probably up there with one of your best studies.
I told you. Tea.
Can you why do you always do that voice?
I don't know.
It's so good.
It's just fun.
It's so good.
He does have an accent though.
Yeah, I like his accent.
How does it go?
Well, let's go on the mushroom party.
Yeah.
We're going to go foraging.
That's messed up. We're not even doing a Four Sigmatic commercial.
I don't know. Yeah.
Yeah. Speaking
He's
of
a fun guy.
Speaking of commercial.
Boom.
Wow. I'm on fire.
Wow. Speaking of commercials, so what's the deal with the new flavors of Magic Spoon? Have you guys tried them all?
I have tried all of them.
There was the what was it? Maple was the other one.
Peanut butter.
Have you tried any of the new ones?
I mean, peanut butter, I've been devouring. So
really,
yes, super good.
Now, have you tried it with? See, I can't have dairy, which pisses me off, right? Because it's got dairy protein in it. I just try a little bit just to taste it, and it's really good.
I know.
Have you tried chocolate milk with the peanut butter? So you have like a kind of like a Reese's type.
I've never done that.
Why?
I don't know why. Like, maybe we throw, because, dude, it's so much sugar in chocolate milk. That's probably
that's
why.
True. Yeah. And you're eating it because you don't want
this
sugar.
This doesn't have any of the sugar. That's kind of like defeats the purpose, right?
Yeah.
I mean, I got 45 boxes to get through before I was like,
you gotta start having friends over and like have a party.
I've been hooking up family and friends when they come over, so I think I'm down to like 36 or something like that. I still got a lot of boxes.
Well, how many do you go
through?
We
gotta do some swaps too, because I got some different flavors. Exchange.
I do have a little hack though, because you know, you can go through that box pretty quick, right? I mean, I can eat 3 bowls, I can empty that box easily, right? So I found these you know, like little, you know, just clear containers that 3 boxes fit in there. So
And you can seal it?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. So does it have the air pump?
Yeah.
That's great.
Well, it doesn't have a pump, but it like air locks or whatever, mm-hmm. you know, like you snap it and it sucks the air out or whatever. So mm-hmm. I use that. And so it's hard for me to measure exactly how long one lasts, but I think I only get about 3 bowls out of them, because I have some pretty big size bowls. I'm getting probably 40 grams of protein every time that I have a serving.
And how do you feel when you eat? You feel good?
Amazing.
Oh, man.
Yeah. I reintroduced that too, because it was something that I wasn't for a couple of weeks there. I mm-hmm. got rid of all these things, but I just reintroduced, you know, Magic Spoon back in, what, I don't know, 4 or 5 days
That was
ago.
One of the first things on the list.
It was. I was like,
just staring at
He's
you.
All broccoli.
Well, you got so many boxes, you got to kind of consider that. Yeah.
Oh, yeah. No, that'd be terrible.
You got to get through them.
Well, and what I've noticed, I know Sal talks about how sensitive he is with whey. I can be too if I do like multiple products that have it, or a
lot. So if you have a shake and then you do a bowl.
Yeah, and I had dairy. If I have a lot of dairy in one day, but like a little bit of cheese or a bowl of Magic Spoon, like, or just one protein shake, doesn't bother me. Mm-hmm. But if I do a lot of it, then it will bother me.
Yeah, I have my son off dairy and gluten because he's looks like he's got my gut, you know, sensitivities. Mm. So I've taken them off those things. And it's so funny. I forget, like for me, it's so second nature because I've been doing it for so long. But when people remove certain things from their diet, they don't realize, like dairy and gluten, for example, they're in a lot of stuff, mm-hmm. like a lot of stuff, like barbecue sauce. You don't think we'll have gluten in it. Soy sauce will have gluten in it.
Speaking of your son, what's going on? I haven't asked you guys in a couple of weeks. What's going on with schools right now? Where are we? Are we still the half and half?
Yeah, his school is half and half.
And does his school also have a bunch of parents that are actually opting out to not even let them come back in?
I think all of them now are 50-50.
You know, my best friend, I told you guys, that's a principal. He was with me this weekend and stepping down after 10 years in admin.
Why?
He said this was his worst year of his life, dude.
Because of all the...
Yeah, dude. I mean, imagine being in that position as a principal.
And then having to answer to everybody.
Well, just
all
think,
parents.
Like, you're damned if you do, you're damned if you... There's no way you win.
No right
it's
way to
become,
do it.
It's become so polarizing and political this last year that you just... It's already a stressful position, mm-hmm. right? Being a principal, dealing with high school kids, dealing with a bunch of teachers and stuff like that. Like, it's already a stressful position. Mm-hmm. Just imagine what it had to been like for a lot of these principals in this last...
I can't imagine brutal. Because, you know, thankfully for, you know, my kids are a little older and there's always typically someone home, right? If they're with their mom works from home. So when they do school from home, it's okay. Mm-hmm. When they're with me, obviously Jessica's at home. But I can't imagine like kids with working single parents or whatever and they had to do school at home. How did you manage it for a year? Yeah. Some of these schools didn't go back for a whole year. Like, how did they manage?
Well, there's a lot. He told me 50% of his school parents opt to not come back at all, too. Mm. So they run like a hybrid.
I think that's a mistake.
They run a hybrid where it's like, you know, yeah, he thinks so, too. Right. Mm. So, and this is, by the way, this is my like super left liberal buddy of mine, too. Yeah. And he still thinks he thinks that what we're not talking about enough of is what that potentially does to kids long term at those crucial ages. Right. So we were talking about all this together just because they were this weekend and Katrina was sharing that she has some friends that had kids like not long before COVID happened. And, you know, they're almost 2 years old now and they've never played with another kid.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah.
It's like you got to think
it
about
it was
that.
Crazy, even just with my own kids. Like we didn't even own iPads. And specifically, I just didn't like the idea of them being glued to that, like that close. But we had to get them because it was the only way you could run some of these programs for school effectively. They did have laptops and everything, but it just didn't work out the way it did. And so it just became this sort of justification. And now it's like this interactive thing with their friends where they only communicate with Roblox or with these different chat, you know, like Insta-chat things where I'm like trying to get them out in the world. And they're like, no, I just want to stay here. And it's really a battle now that was never a battle before.
I mean, my daughter, because you got to understand, okay, people think, oh, you know, 5 months or 6 months is not that long, or a year, what's the big deal? They'll go back to school in a year. When you're talking about a kid, you know, when you're 9 years old, a year is more than one tenth of your life. Like that's a long fucking time.
Yeah.
Imagine skipping fifth grade or fourth grade. Like that's a big deal. Yeah, and I remember when my daughter went back, because when they finally opened up, they asked if parents, and I was one of the first parents that said, yes, I'd love my daughter to come back. She was awkward. She was awkward for like, like a month.
Sure.
Being around other kids and stuff. They don't know what to do, what to say, or you know, whatever. Because it's a skill. The social skills are skills.
It's funny. I mean, there's all these memes going around now about like, you know, because things are kind of opening up and people are coming back. But it's like basically crawling out from under a rock and just be like, oh, you know, hey, and trying to have these social interactions again. It's all these, like, it's just really awkward.
So I saw Vegas just announced they are going like no mask, no restrictions, no nothing in July something. Did you see that? You guys see that? When is it? It's July something?
I think so.
I bet you that is going to be one of the craziest ragers ever.
Oh my God.
People are going to rape shit over there.
Yes, so much penta. I bet you they're going to, it's going to go.
I thought it was a joke anyway because, and I'm not an anti whatever, but I thought it was a joke because when I was there, was it 2 weeks ago? I mean, going through the casino and seeing these people on rascal scooters because they're too obese to walk.
You're pulling their mask down to
and
smoke.
They're smoking cigarettes and they're pulling their mask down to smoke, you know, and doing the thing. Yeah, and I'm like,
what are we doing?
Like, really?
At this point.
Yeah. Thank God you got that mask on, huh?
Who just jumped on the vaccination thing right now too? Is it McDonald's that's doing now?
I saw that.
Is it McDonald's?
Shake Shack. It was another one in New York.
Were they giving away food for?
Yeah, they're giving away food to incentivize.
A lot of companies are doing this thing too, where they're like doing raffles to win $10,000 if you get vaccinated and you get into this pool and they do.
One of those things. I'd rather that approach than the mandate. You know, kind
no,
of
agreed.
Thing.
So I agree.
I appreciate that. But still, it's like those companies. You know, it's not like
Wasn't there a state that actually did a $5 million lottery, if I'm not mistaken? I think there was a state that did a $5 million lottery. So, and the way you enter is by getting vaccinated.
Hmm. Yeah.
In order to motivate people.
This one wasn't that big, but I have a realtor friend, and that's her office. That's what they did. I think it was $10,000 like either a week or a month that they were giving out.
Wow.
And it was a consistent thing they've been doing.
Wow.
But I'm with you, Justin. I mean, I agree. I mean, that's a fair enough. You know what I'm saying? Like, it's not mandating it, but incentivizing people to do it. Yeah. That's a smart way.
I wish that was, the common way they handled it across the board, you know, personally.
Justin, did you see that they just declassified more UFO footage?
Dude, I mean, how much of this, like, can you really just, are you just like, this is all disinformation at this point? Or is it, this just keeps coming out because they're trying to get you to look at something else?
Listen, I've been into UFOs since I was a kid. Justin, probably even more than I have. Okay.
I know, I've been a long time.
Now, before last year.
I was deep in the paint.
Yeah. Before last year, was the Air Force or the Navy or anybody official declassifying UFO videos?
No.
Nothing came out forever. Nothing.
Like Commander Fravor, like you see this, like all these examples on the East Coast.
There's literally a video they just declassified, and it's like this long cigar shaped looking UFO that, like, obviously
they call it the Monica Whiskey.
Wow.
That didn't even come out right.
The Monica Lewinsky.
Wow.
We just talked about her earlier. Yeah. Sorry. Top of mind.
Yeah. Anyway, it's and it, they're showing it doing maneuvers, obviously, that planes that we know of can't do. And then it goes in the water, like goes in the ocean and disappears.
Oh, so they call that something else too, right? Like a USO or?
Oh, right. It's unidentified flying object.
Are you guys just fucking with me right now? Is that real true? Is that true?
Yeah. Serious. Unidentified, what are they?
Submergible.
Yeah, something like that.
So, I don't know.
Why would they call it a flying object if it goes in the water?
What is weird to me is that they're declassifying it, right? So that it was classified before.
That's what I'm saying.
That right away makes it like, okay, even my cackles go up a tiny bit for that, right?
It's like, what are cackles, by the way?
I don't know.
Doug, can you look up cackles?
Yeah.
I've said that before.
It's like the hair, dogs, the hair on the back of your neck. Isn't that,
like, what a cackle,
like the goose pimples?
I'm probably using it wrong.
Yeah, I feel like it's something to have to do with an ankle, but I think cankles.
No,
it gets your cankles up.
Cackles.
But I mean,
I'm probably saying it
wrong. But why all of a sudden are they releasing and talking about and commenting on UFO crazy?
I like,
what are they trying to do?
Whoever's theory is out there that they're literally prepping us. Like, maybe this whole thing was just to get us all vaccinated and get us all ready for the invasion.
Yeah.
You guys.
Yeah. Hey, by the way, they pull their mask off.
Yeah. I think it's to
we've been running the world.
I think it's so we forget about Epstein Island because I think there's just too many powerful political people that are tied to Epstein Island.
That's yesterday's news.
Yeah. What's up, Doug? What you got?
It's hackles, not cackles.
Cackles
like a laugh.
It is hairs. Hairs on the back of the neck, though.
Hackles.
You know what's funny is that none of us here knew that it was hackles.
No, we thought it was cackles.
It should be cackles.
You know,
Wikipedia's wrong.
It's just, we just make words up anyway.
Speaking of declassified video, dude, remember how I talked about nukes the other day? And we're giving you some facts on the biggest nuke ever detonated.
Right, right, right.
The Tsar Bomba. They declassified video of this nuke going off.
What?
Yeah, I gave it to Doug. Maybe Doug can pull it up.
Yeah.
Bro, it looks like they made a sun. Like just a nuke sun was created.
Where did they detonate this?
Well, look, it's a Russian film, so that's why it's all that's why you can't read
crazy
it.
Crazy hieroglyphics.
Is that a parachute? Yeah.
No. So here's it. They're going to show it going off right now.
I can't see.
And that's the timer. But it's
that looks like a 50s movie.
That's when you think it went off.
Oh yeah,
yeah. You think this just happened? This was like back in the 60s, I think, or the 60s. Okay.
I was gonna say it definitely looks like that.
No, okay. So you want to hear some statistics on this bomb, just so you can look at that.
Whoa.
Like it's just. And by the way, I'll give you some statistics. So this bomb packed a punch of 50 megatons. So you guys don't know what that is. So that's equivalent to 50 million tons of conventional explosives.
How do you know Justin doesn't know that?
I mean, you just assume.
Yeah, I know.
That makes an ass out of you and me.
He knows. Wow.
I feel like he would know that.
Look at that, though.
Yeah.
Like, what's going on, right? It's like another sun was created. Then they'll show, like, an aerial view from, like, hundreds of miles away.
So, like, Siberia somewhere? Because this is on land that they're dropping.
Look at this. And then when you go in the sky, it literally hit, I think it hit the stratosphere.
Whoa, dude.
The top of the bomb, like the mushroom cloud, literally went into the upper limit of the Earth's atmosphere. So check this out. Ready for this? That single bomb
We're all breathing that, the remnants of that.
Dude, Russia has like, I think their strategy, by the way, is like, we might not be able to beat you, but if you fuck with us, we'll kill everyone.
Yeah. Yeah.
We're just all going to die.
It's all go big or go home. That's their whole
motto. To this. This is what blew me away. It's 10 times more powerful than all of the munitions expended during World War II. So you take all the bombs and everything that went off in World War II.
Wow.
Times 10. That's one bomb. It's 1,500 times the force of Hiroshima and Nagasaki combined, that one bomb right there.
Dude, wow. they just don't fuck around.
How insane is that right there? Isn't that crazy? I just saw that video this morning. And it was like, I mean, it's fascinating to me, but it's also a bit, obviously terrifying.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm glad that they're not still like lighting those things off.
No. Yeah. So anyway, so I'm gonna get back to fitness now that I've derailed the shit out of this conversation. So I was on an interview, and I thought this was an interesting topic, so I want to hear what you guys think. So I was on an interview talking about, obviously, the book, right? Resistance Training Revolution.
Is this your ABC?
What do you mean?
Are you talking about this? Shout out to you, by the way. That was kind of cool.
Oh, thank you.
Always be closing. Yeah.
On
national TV.
He was on ABC in Texas, right?
Yeah, I got
it. He's finally here. Sal DeStefano, Mind Pump, a show that I've been watching, listening to from YouTube, Spotify, you name it. And Sal joins us here on the show. What's going on, Sal?
Not much. I really appreciate you having me on the show, and thanks for listening to the podcast.
I got tagged. I was like, oh, look at Sal, dude.
On network TV. So you know what's funny about that?
Like, I know.
My family will lose their shit over newspapers and network television.
That's why I told you and I were going back and forth. And he's like, it's not that big of a deal, bro. I'm like, yes, it is. For anybody who's over the age of 35, it's a huge deal still.
Yeah.
Anybody younger than that, it's like, whatever. Yeah. They probably didn't even catch it.
Grandpa jumped out of his seat.
Yeah. You know? So anyway, no, it wasn't that interview. It was one I did right before it, but with the person brought up, who was it? Paul Saladino. So Paul Saladino, I was on his podcast. I don't think it's aired yet. And we were talking about fat loss, and I was talking about studies on resistance training versus cardio. And then he says, what about HIIT? What about high intensity interval training type cardio? Studies show that HIIT cardio burns more body fat, doesn't result in the muscle loss that steady state cardio will result in. So to clarify, studies done on steady state cardio, traditional cardio, and diet. So people only do cardio and diet. When they lose weight, about half the weight they lose is muscle. Obviously not a good thing, right? Mm. So he says, what about the HIIT studies? That kind of cardio shows way less muscle loss and more fat and just more pure fat loss. Mm-hmm. And I said, well, here's why. HIIT is basically resistance training using cardio, right? Mm-hmm. So you know how we've talked about how sometimes people use dumbbells and barbells, but they do in a way where it's not resistance training. They're essentially doing cardio with weights.
To fatigue.
HIIT is doing weights with cardio.
Right.
It's the same thing, but on the reverse, because when you're doing HIIT, you're explosive, you're taking breaks, you're resting. Yeah. The goal is to be anaerobic, not aerobic, with your activity.
So the preservation there was because of the weights.
It's essentially resistance training with cardio. What do you guys think about that explanation?
No, I think it's a great explanation. Yeah, I mean, that's exactly what's happening. But did you go into like the adaptation process though?
Yeah, and I did say to him, like, you know, I would not take somebody who's not already stable, has good mobility and strength, and have them do explosive HIIT cardio because of the explosion. You know, you have to be explosive with it. The exertion is really high, and if your technique isn't good on slow stuff, you don't want to go fast, because if it's bad on slow, it's gonna be way worse on fast, and then you're going to end up hurting yourself.
Yeah, speaking of cardio, I'm actually going to start up. I just, and mainly just to get in more movement. I was talking to Katrina this weekend because I've been trying to get my weight down, and I'm like stuck at like this 220. I am not getting below that. And I'm like, man, my diet is super dialed in right now. I had a drink over the weekend, and I ate out one time. But I mean, normally that's like nothing. I mean, if I'm training and I'm moving around, like my body doesn't feel that or really see that where I am right now. I just think that I'm sitting more than I've ever sat. I sit on the
drive. This is the most sedentary I've ever been in my entire life.
Yeah, yeah. I agree. So I'm literally going to implement it just for that exact reason, just some steady.
Just for your health.
Yeah.
Yeah, because when I was a trainer, when I owned my studio, and I would train, you know, 8 people in a day, 7 people in a day, 10 people a day, you're standing, you're walking, you're moving weights, you're moving equipment. I was never sitting down. I was always on my feet. In here, what we do, we're look at us. Yeah. All we're doing is sitting down.
Well, we need
an
intervention, and so that's where I do see the value in cardio. And like really just bringing up the overall activity for the day. Like that's an important thing. I used to have a lot more active days where I was grabbing weights and I was moving around, I'm showing exercises, and I'm working out on top of that. And to just come in here and sit down and then try and recreate that for like an hour and then sit down again in my car driving, it's just like brutal.
I am going to be a bit methodical about it though before I do it. Like I'm going to measure because I know
I'd love to see how many steps you're averaging.
Yeah, I haven't tracked yet, right? So Katrina just started tracking hers, and she's been like telling me what she's been doing, because she's following Starter where we actually prescribe steps, which she says has been phenomenal. I don't know how many people that listen to the show that actually follow it to that to a T like that, but she's like, you know, I notice a huge difference if I fail to follow that, and she's like, I'll get under the steps for sure. So I'm gonna start there and just kind of see where I'm at. And
so you're not gonna change anything, you're just gonna track.
I'm just gonna track. Now my guess is that I think I'm under 5,000-6,000 steps a day. And then the first thing that I'll do is just make sure that I get like 10 to start. Mm-hmm. And if that means I'm walking on a treadmill or going for a walk outside, I'll do that first. But I have a feeling that I'm just having a piece of cardio equipment like in our office at home, I think is going to be a useful tool for me for that.
Dude, that'll help during the week. I've been really intentional about every weekend and you know, when I get home to get outside and go on these hikes, and been walking a lot more outside and trying to get as much sun as possible. And that really helps like my mood, everything else, energy. You can feel a difference. And then when I come here during the week, it's kind of like, I feel once I get home, I'm like tired. I'm like, I didn't even do anything yet.
Well, because my son doesn't sleep great sometimes and nap, that gets when I get my steps in. Because then I got to put him in the stroller. And I'm like, all right, we're going for a walk, buddy. Yeah. And that's like 2 hours because it takes him 45 minutes to settle down. And then I'm like, all right, now that he fell asleep, I have at least another hour to go. So I'm just walking around the neighborhood with
them. You guys seen all these posts and things people have been tagging us on about all these trainers and people that are all crying about other people promoting to not do cardio and focus more on weights and saying like, how dare them, this is such an effective way to burn body fat, and I can't believe that trainers would say things like that.
No, there's no, look, like, just look at the study.
Ruffled some feathers.
Just
here.
Look at the studies. I mean, and by the way, there's nothing wrong with cardio. There isn't anything wrong with it. Yeah. But if that's the cornerstone of your, and you got to remember this too, this is important. We typically are communicating when we communicate fitness, and we'll say if we're talking to a fitness fanatic, but we're usually communicating to the average person.
Right.
And the average person will work out 2 or 3 days a week. That's it. Yeah. And the average person will pick one form of exercise.
Yes.
And the average person is interested in weight loss.
Yeah. You don't have to sell people doing cardio to burn fat.
No,
that's already the standard.
Yeah. If that's the context, if you work out 2 or 3 days a week, you only pick one form of exercise, and your goal is fat loss, then resistance training is going to be the most, it's going to be superior.
Yeah.
Mainly because of the adaptations it produces. Forget the calories you burn while you're doing it. And also, you know, here's the other thing too. We need to stop valuing exercise for the calories that you burn while you're doing it.
Mm-hmm.
That's not the value of exercise. The value is in the way it changes the way your body adapts and the adaptations that occur. That's where the real value is. So what's the value of just moving and being active? It's not because you're burning the calories. It's rather, it's just good for the cellular function of the body. It's good for circulation. It's got mental benefits. And if you do it outside, you're outside. So that's where you get a lot of those, you know, types of benefits.
Yeah. Speaking of outside, man, I didn't get outside at all this week. Man, we had all of a sudden a cold front. I mean,
it was cold.
Yeah. This weekend, weekend before, you're talking about us being coming back all tan and stuff like that. I think we had like 87. I was like 50 something.
That
60
contrast
something.
Was killing me, dude.
It was way cold and all gloomy and shit all weekend. You know, what I've gotten better about since we've moved out there where it's all gloomy on these days. Is I'm way better now about actually using my infrared, like getting in front of the Juve light. That's just now become a habit. Like, okay, instead of just being consistent with doing it every single day or 3 days a week, I literally try and mirror what's going on outside. Mm-hmm. If I pull up my, you know, weather app and see that it's like overcast, cold, I'm not gonna be outside walking probably. Like, I just need to schedule and make sure that I get in front of that thing for like 10 to 15 minutes. Mm-hmm. I notice a huge difference when I do versus when I don't.
So Jessica has their newer, smaller panel. Remember they sent it to us because I was on the live IG with them?
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, obviously I took that home.
The Juve Go.
I think it's called.
We have that little one up there in the corner.
Yeah, yeah. I think it's kind of like that, but it's a new one, right?
A little
bigger,
yeah.
So Jessica has been using it almost daily on her face.
That's what Cassie does.
And I mean,
yeah, she likes it,
bro. Within, I'd say it took about 3 or 4 weeks, and I kept, you know, look at remember, keep in mind, she's sleep deprived as hell, right? Because we have a baby, and when you're sleep deprived, you typically can tell their skin doesn't look as good.
A little worm.
They're just
tired. She's been using it for 3 or 4 weeks. I'm coming home, I'm like, man, you're getting good sleep. She's like, no. I'm like, you look really good. Like something's different, and I forgot all about that she was using the Juve. You know what it looked like? It looked like she was putting on like foundation or something before I
feel
come
like
home.
I look more tan after I get in front of it. Yeah. I know it's not tanning my skin, but I swear to God, when I get done, I'm like, I look like I just laid in a tanning bed for a few minutes. I swear it does.
Yeah, yeah.
Well, but that might be the glow that it makes you, like you're.
Well, I swear to God, it looked like she'd put something on because she had that. The skin looks like it's what is it? Like there's no blemishes, very smooth. Mm-hmm. I'm like, you put something on. She's like, no, I didn't. And I'm like, holy shit, it's really working. But it took about 3 weeks or so.
Speaking of Jessica, what do you? I know the sleep thing has been probably the most challenging thing right now. What else do you think that she would say is one of the more challenging things right now for her? Like obviously the sleep, that's number one. What else? Have you guys had any hurdles that you guys are dealing with right now?
That's the biggest one. And it's pretty much it. He's the most chill, happy baby ever. Like he's super happy, super cool. He goes with anyone. Very smiley.
Do you feel like he's easier, harder than your other two? Like what are you starting to be reminded of certain phases?
So here's the problem. When my older kids were babies, I worked so much that I think I missed a lot of the nap challenges and stuff like that. So I just don't know. Mm-hmm. Although I think they did sleep a little better at night. But he's not cranky. He's super easygoing. If it wasn't for the sleep, I swear he'd be like the perfect baby when it comes to in terms of how challenging, you know, he is. But now we're doing the feeding. So we're testing different foods, seeing how he poops and whatever. And he even eating, he's like, give me more. I'll just eat more. You know, I know that's a challenge sometimes when you first start feeding kids. You got to figure out what they'll eat or whatever.
Yeah, yeah.
But now he just crushes whatever we give. Oh, so here's what we did yesterday. We gave him, so it's recommended when they do what's called, I don't remember what it's called, where you're, it's more of a natural approach. You introduce different flavors to babies and they can develop a palate or whatever. And one of the things they recommended was to give your baby a small piece of dark chocolate with very little sugar and what, because of the bitter flavor, it introduces them. Mm-hmm. So we gave him a square. And it's like dark chocolate. There's nothing really much in it. And we're trying to see what his expression is or whatever.
Yeah, I was going to say, what did his eyes get all big or what?
No, I mean, because it's not like a sweet piece of chocolate. Yeah. It's relatively bitter.
Yeah.
So it's like, let's see if he likes it. Now, Jessica is a chocolate fanatic.
Yeah.
Loves chocolate. I could whatever. It's not a big deal for me. Anyway, we're giving it to him, and you could see him kind of start to figure it out, like, and then he started, getting into it, and then I'm like, I think that's enough. Like, let's take it away. Oh, dude, we took it away. And we were all laughing because, you know, I don't know about you guys, but when you see your baby have a not like a normal cry, but like a frustrated cry from something like that, it's kind of funny.
It is.
It's like, ah! It's fun to mess with. Yeah, he's like, he does this with his fist. We took video of him while he's doing it.
Yeah, I love it.
He's got chocolate all over his face. And
yeah, I was messing with my kids this weekend. Oh, I actually had this guy come out from Oregon, and they have a company where they do the outfit for like zip lining and
oh, you're getting that
ropes
done.
Course, and like they build
you're
stuff
gonna
like that.
You're going to put that in your back, in the backyard?
Yeah. Yeah, dude. Wow. So it's the same people that did like the zipline course that's like close to me in this camp. And so they were out there anyway to kind of check all the lines and stuff. And so I coordinated it so he could come on my property. And so we got up there and we were starting to kind of, I was telling him all my crazy ideas and all that stuff. And he's like, oh yeah, we can do all of that stuff. I'm like, really? And then we can even have places where you don't have to belay. So you don't have to like have anything clipped. You can just like have these bridges with netting and railing. And so you can have for the adults, I'm going to have an adult kind of like line. So you can go up there and like have a beer and just watch the kids, you know, zip line and climb and do crazy. It's going to be crazy, dude. Just wait,
bro. So give me.
I can't wait.
What does something like this cost? Is it expensive?
I mean, it's expensive, but it's not like crazy going to kill my budget. I'm trying to actually like work in ways of saving money. So you guys know I'm going through this big remodel with the house. I'm going to take a lot of the wood because the wood right now is the most expensive thing.
Oh yeah, that's right.
Yeah, so I'm going to try and see if I can use a lot of the
repurpose
deck.
It.
Yeah,
oh.
And repurpose it for.
Oh, interesting.
Yeah, so that'll save us a lot if I can work all.
I mean, give me an idea, like what to put a whole like. Let's pretend like you
it's
don't.
It's like $5,000 per like you know. Let's just say per
station.
Yeah, station.
And how many stations do you like? Could you do?
Well, you could do as many as you want.
Well, no, you can't. You need a fucking tree guy. You know, however, he only has so many trees in that area.
Oh, yeah. I thought you were asking generally.
Yeah.
Sorry.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, Adam, I think you can do as many as you want.
Yeah. You know, I'm like
all of it.
Yeah. I'm talking about his property. Like, do you plan to have like 10 different stations, three stations, like?
Yeah, like honestly, probably like 8 to 10 stations. Like, I'm gonna go kind of ham with it a little bit. It's not going to like take over the whole landscape. Like you're not going.
You still don't like my.
Dude, I have like 75 trees.
You're going to be the most popular.
Do you really have that many trees?
Yeah, it doesn't look like it.
No, it doesn't look like there's that many. But they're so big. I would have never thought that you have that many on your property.
Yeah, each like ring of redwoods, there's at least like 4 or 5 of them like together. Oh,
wow.
So.
Wow. So you know what I like is that you guys ever seen people put roller coasters in the backyard?
That's I'm trying to get them to do that. I tagged him on. I think it was a Barstool or something.
Oh yeah.
And they had this sick ass like roller coaster you could do.
Oh, that's so cool. Yeah,
and he has the perfect hill for that.
I'm on a slope. So
yeah, I was like, you should so do
bro, that. Your house is going to be the most popular house.
Well, that's kind of what I mean. And that was kind of the idea.
It's or like, not. They're going to be like video games.
Yeah. Kids well, that's why I wanted to create something where it was like it was an attraction for them to just climb and
I love it.
You know, and do stuff that's physical and be outside. So I got to outcompete these freaking video games, man.
Well, good luck, dude.
Yeah.
Hey, real quick, the question portion of this Q&A episode is brought to you by our sponsor, Ned. Now, they have this great product. It's a sleep blend that combines CBD, we all know about CBD, but with another cannabinoid called CBN. Now, CBN has sedating effects on the body. When you take this product, it chills you out. It's the most effective sleep product I've ever tried. No joke, if I take this about an hour later, I need to hit the sack and I sleep very, very hard. Now they take CBD, CBN, and they combine them with very effective natural botanicals to enhance their effects. So if you have issues with sleep, you want deeper sleep, you want more vivid dreams, or you have troubles falling asleep, try this product out. Go check them out. Go to helloned.com. That's H-E-L-L-O, ned.com/mindpump, and you can enter the code mindpump and get a discount. Go check them out.
First question is from Demoose134. What's your take on a Bruce Lee style chain and bar contraption for isometrics?
I have never seen this actually.
You haven't seen that?
No, I have never. I know it now. I know he trained a lot with isometrics. This was something that he believed very heavily in. He found it made his punches and kicks harder. And he was rumored to be able to take a 100-pound dumbbell and isometrically support it at arm's length.
Mm-hmm.
This was like a rumor. I don't know if you ever actually
did this.
That's
crazy, by the way.
Yeah, which is really crazy. Are you familiar with this piece of equipment?
Sorry. Yeah, so, and I've seen a couple companies. I know Dragon Door was one of them. They do a lot of unconventional stuff. Like, they were the first ones I went through some of their certifications for kettlebell and all that, and I saw them had the chain isometric tool. So basically, you have a board, and you have the chain, two chains that connect to then a stick that basically... you can set the chain length. So you set the chain length to wherever you want to go to then have that isometric hold.
So you can stand on it and pull.
So yeah, I could do like emulate a deadlift. I can emulate a row. I can emulate sort of like a, you know, a press position.
Curl.
Over it, whatever. But yeah. It's like, you know, it's definitely just within that station, but you put all of your force and your might into that exercise hold for like 5 to 10 seconds and then rest.
Why have I never heard of this?
I know, I've never seen. You know what?
That would work really well.
Of course, Justin thinks this is brilliant. I mean, this is literally like the axon stick like concept, right?
Right.
So that's brilliant.
Yeah, and that's something that actually I stumbled across that as I was researching a lot of isometric methods out there.
Is that when you first saw this?
Mm-hmm.
I did not know. I'm surprised you don't know because you were like a total Bruce Lee fan.
I knew that he trained a lot with isometrics.
I know, but I've never seen that tool.
Neither have I.
And he also did a lot of bodybuilder poses that he would like exaggerate and make them into isometric exercises in between doing sets like on bench or squat.
Wow, Justin, it even measures like the just like
this is they modernized it apparently and added like a digital scale or whatever.
Oh, well, they're going to find a nice patent that blocks that. So
I was going to say, bro, you better get on that.
Oh, we'll come after him. That's fine.
Yeah. Wow.
Yeah, very interesting. International patents.
You know, it's so strange. It's such an interesting story when you look at the rise and fall of popularity of isometrics. You know, in the early days of resistance training, even Olympic lifting, isometrics were a big deal.
Mm-hmm.
It was something that bodybuilders did and strength athletes did. And feats of strength that they would perform usually involved some kind of isometric hold. The studies, by the way, support isometrics tremendously.
Wow, $500.
For that one.
I know.
You could buy the old school one for whatever or make it yourself without the whatever.
Yeah, but it's not measuring it, right? Yeah. Which you would like
I'll
to see.
I'll show you guys something cooler.
Yeah. but the value of isometrics is incredible. It doesn't, you know, beat up the body. It's got a lot of carryover.
Yeah.
It's a fast way to get strong, a very fast way to get strong.
Mm-hmm.
You can feel it almost immediately when you do it.
I also love it for form and technique. It's such a great way to teach someone how to be aware of their entire body and the way you're positioned while you're trying to contract a specific muscle.
Yeah, it's my favorite use of it.
That's how I use isometrics when training clients more than anything else, is I would get them in a position, whether it be with a cable, a weight, put them in an isometric position, and then I would go move their body, their hips, and like, this is, I want you grounded like this, I want your shoulders back like this, I want your chin to, and then contract as hard as you can. You do that enough times, and then you hand them a weight that's obviously a lot easier to move.
You can build muscle, like it's such a legit training method. It just doesn't have good marketing. You know, it's like people, it's not sexy to see a video of somebody just kind of staying there
and flexing,
you know, like see the struggle in their face. Yeah. You know, that's what. But it's so effective if you apply it into your training, and it complements basically everything. And also, it's safe. It's one of the safest training methods out there that you can just internally just back off on your effort.
Yeah, like jiu-jitsu guys, you see a lot of them start to incorporate isometrics because a lot of the positions and holds require a tremendous amount of isometric stamina, strength, and endurance. So when you're in a position, or here's a common thing when you're doing like a gi choke on someone, you have good technique and setup, but if your hands and forearms give out from the isometric holds, well, then you lose or whatever. So it's very interesting, and it's something that I think, again, you don't see anybody doing it, which is interesting to me, because the studies on isometrics are, it's not like, oh, you have a little bit of value. It's incredible.
Yeah.
You just look them up for yourself. It's incredible the value that they can provide, pretty much. And you can, and here's the thing with them. You can add them to any routine and you run very little risk of overtraining.
Mm-hmm.
So it's like, you know, when you're training, like, oh, I can't add that new thing because it'll push me over the edge. I have to take something away. With isometrics, usually you can add them and it won't take away from your body's ability to recover too much.
Next question is from Way Too Fit. Can a 10 to 15 minute trigger session every day be beneficial for muscle gain and fat loss if the client has time restrictions with work.
Yeah, trigger sessions have tremendous value.
They're the best for that.
They're incredible for that. So a trigger session essentially is a short, and I usually say 8 to 10 minutes, right? 8 to 10 minute mini, and I use the word lightly, workout. But essentially what you're doing is you're doing a low to moderate intensity workout. You're aiming for a little bit of a pump.
It's like a pump session.
Yeah, or you can make it more mobility focused. And you do it shortly, and ideally you do several of these a day, two or three of these a day. When I do trigger sessions every time, it's like within 3 or 4 days, I could tell a difference in my muscle shape. I could tell a difference in fat loss, energy, everything.
How in depth did you go in the book in this?
With trigger sessions?
Yeah.
I didn't talk about trigger sessions.
Oh, you didn't at all?
No, I kept it very basic because we're talking, and here's the thing,
it's kind of an advanced technique.
Yeah, and here's the thing, like in the resistance training revolution, I talk about sets, reps, tempo. Right. Like, you know, you got to imagine the average person that you're talking to.
Their first introduction to weights in general.
But I mean, trigger sessions are not advanced in the sense that they only benefit advanced people.
No.
It's just, you got to get the basics first.
It's an advanced concept, right? Yeah. No, that's what I mean by advanced.
Yeah. But yeah, no, it's great. And you know, back in the day, we didn't call it trigger sessions, but I would have clients do, you know, hey, I tell you what, every morning, why don't you practice and do, you know, 3 sets of 10 body weight squats, which is kind of easy for you. Just do that in the morning. Or, you know, at work, every 2 hours, I actually used to do this with quite a few clients, I'd have them have like an alarm that would go off on their watch or something. And every couple hours, go ahead and do 5 minutes of this particular band exercise. And they would notice improved productivity. Mm-hmm. They'd notice, you know, a little bit of strength gains that we would see translate into our workouts.
Who was it that did the greasing the groove? Was that Pavel? Who was it?
Pavel, yeah.
Yeah, Pavel did that. And then Rich Piana, I forgot what he called
feeder
it.
Feeder sessions.
Yeah, very similar type of a concept, right?
Yeah, and you know, in terms of Dr. Ed Thomas, he applied something kind of similar, but it was more... you know, basic exercise calisthenic type stuff in between for school. So they would take breaks, like lots of like planned breaks where they would have these physical poses and different exercises that they would do. And they in turn had some of the best performance and numbers out of anybody in any kind of, you know, competitive state around them.
Yeah. No. And if, you know what the biggest, so when I did them the first time, and remember the story goes, I witnessed blue-collar workers in my family who had muscular body parts that correlated to their physical job, right? So, you know, like a mail carrier, they all had great calves, and the mechanics in my family had great forearms. And the reason why I thought of trigger sessions is like, look, if you're a mechanic for 30 years, yeah, I'm sure the first few months your forearms get sore, but after that, it's now you're adapted, it's a low level intensity activity, and yet they would have forearms that rivaled, you know, like amateur bodybuilders or whatever.
Yeah.
So I thought, okay, there's something to this. When I applied it, I did not expect to feel and see some of the other the benefits, which were cognitive and energy-wise. It was like, I would just feel so sharp. I mean, one of the reasons why we work out before we podcast now is it makes us so much sharper.
Yeah.
I mean, just throughout your day, just do 5 minutes of exercise.
I love that. So when you got me doing it, I actually took our bands and I would keep it downstairs where my TV room was at and just hang it in a closet door that was in there. And I just made a habit of like, mm-hmm. if I sat watching, you know, 2 hours of TV or something like that, to just, because you know, you start to feel lethargic, yep. and especially on a weekend, right? Maybe it's a Saturday, I kind of slept in, kind of chilling, but then I catch myself where I've been just like into the couch forever, feeling even more lethargic. Now I don't even want to go get like a full workout in. Hopping up and doing a trigger session completely changed.
Same thing. I had one in the pantry and I would just like, after I was sitting too long watching TV, I'd go grab it and just do some pull aparts and get my chest, you know, up and just get my posture right. And it was like gold.
And it's so easy because you're not committing to like a full workout. It's literally 10 minutes long, if that. And it just takes, and it's not really hard, but how you feel afterwards is amazing.
You're aiming for maybe a little pump. Maybe you get a little burn in the muscle. Nothing even close to intense. And here's the best, I mean, in my opinion, here's a selling point. If you have a weak body part, let's say you're having trouble making your butt grow or your biceps or whatever, do the trigger sessions for that weak body part. Just do them on a, you know, I'd say 5 days a week, do a couple a day. Watch what happens to that weak body part.
Yeah.
It responds very, very well.
Next question is from Plain Janette. She is wanting to know tips or experience with heartburn or acid reflux.
Justin's wheelhouse right here.
Yeah, no, I've gone through all kinds of different options with. I mean, I was the guy that was like taking Prilosec and all these other different medications to, just to try to eliminate it and forget it.
When did that start for you? How old were you? Do you remember?
I mean, it's been with me ever since I can remember, pretty much.
Really?
Yeah, maybe I would say teen years for the most part, because you start really kind of eating crap and you introduce all that stuff, because I'm kind of going away from what I'm eating at my parents, and I'm eating more fast food and things. Once I started eating fast food, it was just like
a whole tub of cookie dough, right?
Yeah. Right. I mean, do you remember how long you were like naive to it though? Like it was happening and you didn't like, you're just like, it's probably just everybody feels this way.
Yeah, it really didn't even dawn on me until after college.
Yeah.
Like I just assumed that was something that was handed off to me from my dad, because he has a really bad case of it himself, and my brother as well. My dad actually associated it though with sleep apnea, which I found out could contribute towards it as well. And so that was something that I tested out and teased out, and I was like, thank God that's not it. I didn't want to have one of those Darth Vader machines, hooked up to me at night and carry that thing around when we travel. Yeah.
I would tease you.
The jokes alone would easy, just right? kill me.
You know what though? If you have sleep apnea, that's a life changer. I have family members who got it for sure. And they're like, I wish I used it before.
Yeah. And so I've tried a lot of things. And then we had talked about like with a couple of functional medicine doctors, like they had mentioned that it's an acid. I wasn't producing acid at the right times. It was a timing issue. And I had trained my body to basically like through this whole sphincter valve thing, whatever you want to call it, like it was releasing it at the wrong time. And so it would go up in my throat, like when I'd lay down at night versus having it there to digest as I was eating. And so to take these HCL pills was a strategy. And I went through that process for a while, and it did somewhat help. But the latest thing now that I'm on is this licorice extract. I was trying to look that up while you guys were talking.
A sphincter valve? That's like a real thing?
Yeah. Any muscle that does this, Adam.
Yeah.
So it's not just your butthole.
Sphincter says what?
Yeah. Oh, that's
a sphincter.
Yeah. That's the definition of that?
Yeah, it's a sphincter muscle.
God, I learned something new every day hanging out with you guys.
Adam immediately is like, you have a butthole?
That's what I was. I know Doug was looking the same way too. Doug looked at me and gave me the same look I had. Like, what? Did he just?
Doug just knows our humor. He's like, someone's going to say something. You know?
So a deglyceride licorice, just for anybody that's curious. That's what I'm on now.
So
some red vines?
No, it's pills, dude.
So a lot of those proton pump inhibiting drugs, like the ones you used to take, I know I fucked this up for Justin, because they're effective. You take them, you don't get heartburn.
Oh, you know what got me off those? The study about dementia.
I know.
Yeah, it scared the shit out of me.
I know. I'm sorry about that. Yeah, but he's like, man, I take these all the time. They totally work for me. So, you know me, I'm like, I'm going to look this up and see what's going on. And I find these new studies showing that these protein pump inhibitors are connected to cognitive decline and dementia later in life. So I'm like, fuck.
Mm-hmm. Share it with Justin.
Yeah, it's already happening. How long have you been taking these?
So you're saying
that the football or
black
that.
The black licorice is a natural way to try and help. And now you take it right before you eat. How often do you take it?
Like twice a day. And so I've been taking that and also adjusting my diet. And that's something anybody that's suffering is through that as well. I really like highly suggest you go through an elimination diet and reintroduce different types of food, so you can really know what's the biggest offender.
So SIBO is very closely connected to acid reflux. So SIBO is small intestinal bacteria overgrowth, right? So bacteria builds up where it's not supposed to. And if you have SIBO and your heartburn or acid reflux is due to SIBO, if you get rid of the SIBO, which it is curable, so SIBO is curable. Now, in a lot of people, it can come back. But if you cure it, either with antibiotics or herbals, by the way, herbals in more recent studies were shown to be just as effective as the antibiotics. If you cure it and get rid of it, your problem will be gone. And some of these supplements contain lots of these kind of antimicrobials in them, you know, peppermint oil and oregano and garlic and some of the stuff. But essentially what you do is you take them about 15 minutes before you eat, then you eat, and then what it does is it sits in your gut. You throw the food at the bacteria. The bacteria comes out to eat the food, but because of the presence of these herbals are in there, it'll kill them. Mm-hmm. The process of treating SIBO can take as long as
Is that similar to how like a probiotic is working too?
No, probiotics bacteria.
Okay. Mm.
So these are antimicrobials.
Right.
They actually kill.
So it's like bacteria. Shaving away at it slowly.
So like peppermint oil, oregano oil, I said garlic, and there's some other stuff, but I took two herbal concoctions, the ones that were in a study for SIBO, and I didn't get heartburn. Mine's different. But I did have SIBO, and it's called dysbiocide is one, and then FC-cidal is another. And those are the ones that I saw in studies that they actually use. Or you can go get antibiotics. But the problem with the antibiotics is they can be very expensive.
Well, and another thing, too, is it's stress was a big component for that that would set it off like almost immediately and speed of eating, too. So I really had to concentrate on slowing down, you know, taking deep breaths and eating slowly. And that really helped. And it's just kind of annoying because I'm like the last guy to finish food all the time now. But it really does help. And also eating after like 6 o'clock at night.
It's amazing. And you still get it all over yourself. It's crazy. Just that.
I'm still hungry.
Next question is from MFS Wellness. What are some of the most effective psychological tactics you've used to help clients overcome their attempts to quit on themselves? When is it appropriate to refer a person to a professional behavior therapist?
All right, so let's start with the first part. So, and I hate to use the word tactics. I feel like that sounds like you're tricking someone, which is silly. You're not going to trick someone into long-term fitness and health success. Now, my experience, the best strategy is how you go into the process to begin with. So if you go into it with self-hate, I hate my body, I hate the way I look, that's it, I can't take it anymore, you're going to fail. You have to go in from a standpoint of self-care. And then there's another part, which is I always talk to my clients about motivation and why it's fleeting, not to rely on it, and rather to develop the skill of discipline. When someone goes in with self-care, with a slow, methodical build discipline, the skill of discipline approach, the success rate is much higher. You see more balance, and you see less of the quitting, or at least quitting forever with their workouts.
So I have two things. One, to take from Jordan Peterson, aim low, right? So doing something like not giving them this massive target. A lot of times they come in and they have this huge goal and they're focused on that huge goal. So getting them away from thinking about this goal that you know is going to take, you know, months or potentially years, and not to focus on that, and to give them small, obtainable, realistic goals that they can start hitting them like within the first week, right? So I think that's the first strategy. The other thing that, and I was just talking to Vicky as she was doing our lining us up today, and we were talking about when I competed, and she was asking me questions about like, you know, oh, you know, what do you attribute like the success of it and this and that? And I'm like, you know what's funny? It's like, there wasn't anything magical at all. In fact, probably the thing that made the biggest difference was the consistency. I never in that my life have been that consistent with my diet and training, ever, even as a personal trainer. I mean, I still fall off and have weekends where I do whatever. And one of the games that I played with myself was I would compete with how many days in a row that I did well on the diet and or training. And that could, when you're day one, that's zero. So accomplishing 1 or 2 days in a row is your first record, right? And so let's just say inevitably by day five, you have a mishap. You eat off the diet or you don't get your training session in like you're supposed to. And so I would start back at zero again. I would pick myself back up. It's not a big deal. Shit happens. It's inevitable. But now the new goal is to beat 5 days in a row. Can I get 5 days in a row, more than 5 days in a row, which so six would be a success or more. And I would just keep doing that until, you know, 5 days, 7 days, 13 days started to turn into months. And then eventually in this case turned into years. And so I would do the same thing with clients with the idea of like, all right, let's, you know, here's our small goals. Our goal is to see how many days we can be consistent with this. Once they do that, it's okay. When they come to me, oh, Adam, I fucked up. I did this week. That's okay. You know, you've got 9 days of us being really good. Now, okay, tomorrow we start at zero again. The goal is to get to 10. And you keep doing that. I found a lot of success with helping clients stay on track.
Now the brilliance of that, what you're saying, and there's a lot of different versions of what you're saying, but the brilliance of it is you're comparing yourself to yourself. And you're comparing yourself to yourself recently. So it's a fair comparison. I think one of the biggest mistakes people make is they compare themselves to other people,
yep.
or they compare themselves to themselves when it was a totally different circumstance. Like, man, when I was in my 20s, I was like so dialed in. Like, yeah, but you didn't have a mortgage, you didn't have kids, you didn't have, you know, this type, this job. Like, so what you're saying is very brilliant, because it's the only real fair comparison is, okay, how did I just do recently? Mm-hmm. Okay, I did this well. Can I beat myself like I did, you know, last week with what I'm doing? Yes, I can. And then you get that kind of that momentum going.
Yeah. And usually people that are in that situation where it's like, oh, like you feel that sense that they're not coming back and they just want to quit. And it really, it's assessing like how much, you know, they're taking on. Like what are all these things in your head that you think like aren't working, and what's, you know, like how can we bring it back to just focus on a few things that, you know, like this is just something I do all the time. And let's like slowly build on that. It's one of those things. As a young trainer, it's like, why won't they do this? And let's figure out a strategy to, you know, make you more consistent. And it just has never worked like that for me. Like, I have to be there as the accountability, and I'm always here as the rock for you to come back to it and go through this. But really, it's like this is your journey, and so you have to basically figure that out.
Well, and to address the second part of this question, I don't think it's ever a bad idea not to hire somebody that's a professional. If they are in a position where either work or they can afford to have a professional, a mental health expert that is supporting them through this, it's only going to help. Now, we all have experience in that. We're all well read in that area. We know that part of the job is kind of like being that, although we're not one. So anytime that I can get a professional to assist me, mm-hmm. I mean, I would recommend that right out the gates. Certainly if all the tactics and the things that I'm trying, I'm continuing to fail, or they can't get past a mental hurdle, right? They keep coming back and mm-hmm. telling me like the same excuse or the same story. If I, cause here's the thing, that's a lot of times people will say this, the same story over and over and over. If they're giving me what I think is kind of that same story, and I've tried to help them overcome that, I'm going to really push in that direction. But again, I mean, it wouldn't hurt him to do that.
My
right out the gates.
Best success with clients was when they worked with me and a therapist. And I always would work with the therapist. By the way, if you're a trainer, here's the strategy. What you don't do is tell your client, "Hey, I think you need to see a therapist," because that'll I'm serious.
Yeah, yeah.
That's not going to work. What you do is you find a good therapist, and then you know them by name. And then when the person hires you, working with them, say, "Hey, look, I've had some other clients have a tremendous success with working with me and, you know, John Smith," or whatever their name is. So when they work with me and John Smith, it's incredible. We're a really good team. It's very effective. Let me know if you want me to send you over to go see him. Just like that. Yeah. Leave it at that. Now, the other times I would recommend is when you're dealing with severe obesity, or there's any hint of some kind of a dysfunction, a clinical dysfunction that has to do with eating. So if someone says to you, "Hey, I've had an eating disorder before," or "It looks like there may be some issues with that." Again, have someone that you have a name of that you can recommend to them, and make sure you recommend it in a way that you think is effective. So again, I would say something like, "Hey, I work with this other person who works with all my clients. Oh my gosh, we're such a great team.
Joseph Smith.
Yeah, let me know if you'd like to."
One of the best ways of doing that to make people feel comfortable is to say that you do that with a lot of your clients.
Yes.
I have a lot of success with most of my clients that choose to do this, so they don't feel like they're alone. They're the only ones that got to go see a mental therapist with you.
But I mean, working with them is what I would do all the time. So I'd work with the therapist. And of course, we get the permission from the client. The client knows that we're sharing information. And the therapist would say something to me like, "Hey, they're, you know, we talked a lot about eating, and you know, it would not work well for them to count calories or to count macros, or don't weigh them. This is not something that you should do." And I'd say, "Well, I'm going to focus on performance then. We're going to focus on strength. What do you think?" They'd be like, "Yes, that's a good idea." But working together like that, oh my gosh, so successful.
By the way, if you are a personal trainer, this is one. Someone DM'd me the other day about getting their kines and a minor in psychology.
Oh gosh!
And I said, "Man, you probably
beautiful combo.
You can't. I don't think you could come up with a better combo." So if you're a trainer and you have either kines or you've got national certifications, I highly recommend reading in this direction, because I found a passion for reading this direction, and I can't tell you how much it helped with coaching these types of clients. Because I mean, are all clients for that matter, even if they don't have some sort of a disorder or they're mentally challenged in this area. I mean, having that background and understanding and empathy when you're talking mm-hmm. to any and all clients
tremendously valuable.
Oh, yeah. I mean, towards the end of my career, I had in-house, I had a physical therapist, a massage therapist, and an acupuncturist. So those were the people in-house. But I also worked with a hormone specialist who was off-site. So I'd find these people, and I'd work with them, talk with them, and I'd say something like, hey, I'm a local trainer. I would like to send clients your way who I think may have hormonal issues. And what are they going to say? No, of course. And of course, you find a good one and see how they work out. So I had someone that I would refer to there. I had therapists that I would send people to. So I'd have this repertoire of people that I could refer to. And you know how valuable that made me as a trainer? It's like, I know someone. Don't worry. We can work with them. And it was wonderful. I think that should be every trainer's goal if you want to be really effective and successful. Look, if you like Mind Pump, if you like our information, head over to mindpumpfree.com. Check out our free stuff. You won't believe what we'll give you for free at mindpumpfree.com. You can also find all of us on Instagram. So you can find Justin at mindpumpjustin, me at mindpumpsal, and Adam at mindpumpadam.
There's kind of a difference between wanting and liking. And what scientists who kind of study people, they kind of discovered that when you get cravings for this food, the wanting goes up, but the liking doesn't necessarily go up. It can even go down. It's like we want this stuff and then we eat it. And